Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, wherever you may be. I hope you can see me. I'm not sure if you can also hear me. I hope everything is fine. Welcome to today's session on whether it's safe to run exams now in view of the corona situation. My name is Simona Petrescu, and I work for Cambridge Assessment English, providing teacher support in Europe, and I'm based in Germany. But presenting this session today, we have Laurie Caton, who is the Cambridge Exam Centre Manager of Swiss Exams, which is our largest exam centre in Switzerland, which last year celebrated 30 years of activity. A few words before we start. Like most of you, we're working from home, but we're aiming to give you the best experience we can. But we are relying on home Wi-Fi mostly, so please bear with us if we have any issues. During the webinar, please use the chat box if you want to type any comments, but please use the Q&A box for any questions that you have to our presenter, to Laurie. If it's something that we can answer straight away, we'll type the answer for you, but we will keep some questions for the short question and answer session at the end. So don't worry if your question isn't answered straight away. So let's get started then. Laurie, over to you.
Okay, can everyone hear me?
Yes, we can, Lori.
Yes, you can. Okay, good. Thank you for joining this presentation. The name is it safe to do exams now? I hope that by the end of the presentation, we'll all be able to agree that it is safe if certain guidelines and restrictions are followed. I realize and I appreciate that this is very local because most of the things that I will be saying will apply to Switzerland, but I do hope that nonetheless you'll be able to benefit from the things that I will be showing you. Again, as my name was already mentioned, my name is Laurie. I'm the SEM for Cambridge English Exams. At the same time, I'm also the CEO of Swiss Exams. We have our headquarters here in Winterthur, Zurich, but we run exams in all the big cities in Switzerland, all the Cambridge English qualifications, including Lingua Skill and IELTS. We run both paper-based and computer-based exams. We have approximately 15,000 candidates annually, and I've been with Cambridge since 1989. I mention that especially because in all those years, I have never been faced with such a crisis, such a serious crisis, and so many challenges. On top of the corona crisis, we also had one of the large Cambridge centers in Switzerland close from one day to the next. So in addition to the corona situation, we had to try to give and find solutions to lots of candidates who were a bit lost at the time. I will speak first about the written exams, and then I'll also show you some pictures for the speaking test, which I almost found a bit more challenging. So we'll move to that. Before starting to run the exams after March, we had to do certain things. First, our last exam day before the lockdown was on the 14th of March. We had government supervision then. And I mention that because that exam went very well, and they were very impressed by what we did, mostly by the tracing that we can do with these candidates or the details we have. And that helped us then to get permission to run the exams in the other cantons. Then we had the complete lockdown until the 8th of May, and we had a special permission was granted to us. It was really an exception still at that time. In order to get that permission, we had to hand in a security and safety concept. This safety concept included permission from the candidates, or that is confirmation from the candidates that they would agree or that they would sign this declaration, that they agree with the procedures we put in place, also that they have not been in contact with someone who is who has been infected, and that they themselves feel well. If they do not feel well at the time, they have to get confirmation from a doctor to tell us that it is not the COVID virus that they're suffering from, and they would still like to take the exam. Also, what we did, we made sure that all, we had the printing of exam papers done locally. That was new for me. That has never happened in 30 years. So we did that. But then when the exam papers came back from the printer, we sealed every envelope, and I myself and a staff member put our initials across the flap to make sure that the supervisors and invigilators knew these papers were not touched by anyone else and that they were okay to be used then. On the next picture now, we have a copy of this COVID form. It's actually just one sheet. These are the both of the sides, but the candidates have to sign twice. Once, the one on the left side shows you that they agree with all, they have instructions for exactly what will be expected of them on the day, and that they agree with these procedures, so that we have no one to show up and to say that they didn't know what was coming. The right side is the one, is the medical statement that tells us that they have not been near infected people, that they feel all right, or if they don't, they have to have this doctor's confirmation. I think the most important thing, and this is really good for us with Cambridge, is the contact tracing. We know exactly who these candidates are, where they're taking the exam, when they're taking the exam. Actually, the seating plans really made sense because we were able to even show where they sit during the exam. And the government was quite impressed by that. All of our exam staff must wear masks and gloves when working with the candidates and when working with the exam scripts that are returned to us after the exam. When they're in the hall, especially the written exam, when they're near the desk of the candidates, they must keep at least 1 meter away from them so that they are not touching them or any of the material. We have hand sanitizing liquid and disinfectant in all exam rooms and in all waiting areas. We also told the government that we would not be serving food during the speaking test breaks. So the examiners have to now bring their own food. As I said, the candidates are, this is now about the written exams. They're informed about what they will be expected to do. They are not allowed to gather in front of the building as usually before we let them into the hall. They must come to the desks immediately when they arrive at the venue. They are not allowed to leave their desks during the break except for a toilet break, and they must take their food and drinks, of course only water, to their desk before the exam starts. They're asked to be careful, of course, with the food, especially in the CB rooms. Now, some of those restrictions have loosened. They are now allowed to wait in front of the building, but they must wear masks when they cannot keep the social distancing, which is not possible. So we ask them to put their masks on now before they leave the exam room so that they are prepared for the situation outside of the exam room. Again, they will be, of course, allowed to go to the toilets, but they go in groups of maximum five, depending on the size of the restrooms. An invigilator manages all of this, monitors it. They only let them go in these groups. They must be standing 2 meters apart, even when they're waiting in line to go to the toilet. When they come back, the invigilator makes sure that they immediately return from the restrooms to the exam room. All candidates receive, this is a normal procedure, they receive a pencil from Swiss exams. Normally, they are allowed to decide whether they will take the pencil with them at the end or not. Now, under the corona situation, they must take it with them because we do not touch anything that they have left there. We do not remove it. For the listening paper in the CB exam, we have covers for the headphones. They're exchanged after every exam. There are new ones put on for the new candidates. The speaking test check-in functions the following way, and I'll show you some pictures following this slide then to show you what I mean. They have to hand in at the check-in their COVID consent form, the one that I spoke about before this declaration. Of course, they have to show their ID. For that, they have to remove the masks if they're wearing them and the entry statements. Candidates get their mark sheets also at the check-in desk because they will need them for the second ID check in front of the exam room. The picture taking is absolutely no problem. That works fine. We only allow one set of candidates that are for one test slot into the waiting room. So, for example, if we have three speaking test rooms, we'll have six candidates in the waiting room. The new candidates do not enter until the others have left, only after the others have left. In the waiting room also, we ask candidates to sit the 2 meters apart. The candidates receive also at check-in a dead zone bag from us. They are instructed to switch off their phones and put them into the bag. And I'll show you what that bag looks like in a minute. This is now the corridor that goes up to, that leads up to the check-in desk on the left. At the end of the corridor is the waiting room. On the floor, you'll see the marks where it shows the candidates exactly the 2 meters that they have to stand apart while they're waiting to move up to the check-in desk. On the right-hand side, you'll see a red poster, which was the government poster, the instructions to all the people in Switzerland. This has now changed to blue. And of course, we constantly have to update whenever the government issues a new poster. We have to make sure that that is in all different locations in the venue, in the exam venue. Here now we can see the check-in desk. We see the supervisor wearing the gloves, wearing the mask. Getting ready to take pictures. On the right side of the picture, we'll see the entrance to the waiting room. The candidates waiting in front of the exam room, once they leave the waiting room, are also placed 2 meters apart. I'll show you that in a minute. And after they, after the speaking test, the candidates take their phones out of the dead zone bag. They drop them into a plastic box or a bag, depending on the venue, and then they are not used again for 1 week. Then they are disinfected again and used again for the new exam. But on the day, all new candidates get new dead zone bags. The candidates are asked to leave right after the exam and not stand around, and the examiners will disinfect all surfaces once the candidates have left the room. On the left, you can see the waiting room. You can see the big distance between the chairs. On the right, you will see the chairs in front of the speaking test room, again at 2 meters distance before, that is where the candidates will sit for their second ID check and before they go into the exam room. The desks, of course, in the speaking test room must be 2 meters apart. That means between the two candidates, as well as between the interlocutor and the assessor, and between the interlocutor and the candidates. I will show you pictures for that as well. Candidates have picture prompts, pictures or prompts, and they're placed close enough so that they can see them, but they are asked or instructed not to touch them. Examiners stay in the rooms during their breaks. If they leave the room, they must wear a mask. During the exam, they can decide whether or not they would like to wear one, provided that they are 2 meters away from the candidates. If it's less than the 2 meters, then they have to wear one. Here now you can see that the assessor in the back is wearing the blue gloves. The interlocutor has chosen not to wear gloves and not to wear a mask. Both examiners are not wearing masks. In the front, you'll see the two desks. To the left and the right is each candidate. In the middle, there is a desk with their pictures, close enough to them to see the picture, to be able to talk about it. But as I mentioned before, they are instructed not to touch it. Here is the famous dead zone bag, which is a real lifesaver. It costs a bit of money to get it initially, but it's worth every penny. This is the dead zone bag. Once the phone is switched off and in there, even if it's switched on, but we ask them to switch it off, it cannot communicate with anyone or anything. It was tested in Cambridge and we got permission to use it. By the way, that permission is global. So if you can get some of these bags, they will really make life a lot easier for you. On the right-hand side, you'll see two different kinds of disinfectants. The one with the green label is the one for the hands. The red bottle is the one for the surfaces. When they enter the room, they see this sign and they will put the dead zone bags on that sign. So at all times, we know where those phones are and what's happening with them. After the exam, as I said, they're left in this box on the floor. They throw it in there and they're not touched. Then they are left there for a week and then they are disinfected. After each set of candidates, the windows are opened And of course, they are asked to leave the venue immediately after the exam. All the surfaces, of course, are disinfected as well. After an exam day, and here I'm talking mostly about the paper-based exams, these scripts that come back to us are carefully counted to make sure that none have disappeared. This was even more important during the crisis. Our staff must wear gloves when they're checking these scripts, and all the surfaces in the exam rooms, the paper-based exam rooms, as well as the CB exam rooms, the computer-based exam rooms, are disinfected. All rubbish bins are emptied, and all surfaces everywhere are also disinfected. The toilets are cleaned after each exam day, and the rooms are ventilated. Is it safe to run exams now? I believe it is, but it is essential to have certain things in place. A very good and solid security safety concept, functional infrastructure, disinfected material, floor markers, gloves, masks, everything that goes with it. Clear communication, that's extremely important to both the candidates as well as the exam staff. Then, of course, it's important to retrain the exam staff to keep them regularly updated as to the situation at the moment and any changes that have to be followed. And then, of course, as always, it's consistent monitoring that actually is extremely important. Are these regulations being followed? If we have government supervision, we do not want to get in trouble because we want to be able to continue to run the exams. That's sort of the end of my presentation. Thank you very much for listening, and lots of luck with running safe exams. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Laurie. It's been quite an informative talk, and there are quite a few questions here in the Q&A box. Some questions go around the idea whether what you have shown applies around the world, whether these are binding regulations for all centers around the world. Could you make a comment here?
Yeah, of course they're not. As I said at the beginning, they're very local to Switzerland, but Switzerland is very strict. And I think if these are procedures that we use here, I think there would hardly be anyone who would have any objection to them being used in other places. They may not meet the full requirements, like there is no obligatory mask regulation. Maybe that's different in other countries. That I don't know. But it is more local to Switzerland, what I've shown.
That's right. So to add on to this, all these safety and security concepts like the one that you have presented are bound to be quite local because they have to be in line with the local legislation. So what you are showing here is how your center has come up with this wonderful concept. Another question about the speaking test is whether there have been or you have found that there were communication problems between examiners and candidates due to masks.
No, we had no difficulty with that because not very many candidates wear masks and not many of our examiners. They are sitting 2 meters apart. I suppose that solved some of the problems, but we had no difficulty with that whatsoever.
Mm. And I don't know if you have encountered a situation where you wanted to organize the exams, but the premises had to remain closed. Did you have any?
Yes, we did. We did have a few of those situations. We had to look for other premises, long hours and trying to find other premises, but we were able in the end to manage. We got to know a lot of new premises through the exercise, but yes, that was a problem. Some of the hotels were closed, of course, but we were able to manage somehow.
Right. So somebody is asking you, with restrictions slowly being lifted, have you found that administration of paper-based written components is slowly going back to the normal. For example, the invigilator standing closer to the candidates during the ID checks, for example, or wearing masks. So are you noticing any relaxation of these requirements or measures? Well,
the government has relaxed that a bit in that it's 1.50 meters now and not the 2 meters. But we still advise our exam staff to keep the distance when they can, to wear the masks and the gloves. We don't force them to, but we do force them to wear the masks. The gloves sometimes are now not compulsory. I feel it still should be. I think we have to be really careful. But the government has loosened the restrictions by saying they're now allowed to wait outside, but they can wait outside only if they wear the mask. So there's still a restriction there, but it's a little bit looser than it was.
Okay. And somebody was asking, talking about distancing and so on. How did you solve the problem of running the ID checks just before the written papers when the invigilator is supposed to go around?
Yes. We ask the candidates if they're not young learners. The young learners is a bit difficult there. We wear the gloves so that we can actually touch the ID. I know we don't have to do the ID check for young learners, but we do it to get them used to the procedure for their KET and PET exams. For the adult candidates, we do ask the candidate to lift up the ID, turn it around. In Switzerland, the validity date is on the back, so the candidates hold up the ID and we do not touch it.
Mm.
That's how we solved that problem.
Okay, I see. And another question, this time about candidates possibly not being able to attend an exam due to a positive test result or having to quarantine. Have you had such cases? What happened?
We did have cases where candidates did not want to attend, not that they had the COVID virus, but they were afraid to attend. We had it would have taken too long to go into that, but they had a so-called Corona code that they could submit and they could attend the exam at a later time for free. So we did have that, and some candidates did make use of that. That was hugely, I think, appreciated by those candidates who were afraid to attend. So right. We gave them that code and then they could log in with the code and could postpone their examination.
Right. Okay. I have to say there are quite a few questions that are a bit beyond the scope of this talk. They are very specific, either coming from, I take it, staff from exam centers or speaking examiners. I would ask you to contact the relevant colleagues, whether it's customer services dealing with our relationship with the centers or your team leader support in your country, because all these questions about regulations and certification and are bound to be, as I said, are bound to be very local. So I would ask you to go back to the normal communication channels. Otherwise, let me thank you, Laurie, once again for something that was very clear with lots of pictures and extraordinary examples. To remind everyone that there will be a recording indeed of all the sessions, including of this one. So you can watch this again and again, and maybe the quality of the sound, or somebody was complaining about not being able to read properly, will be much better. Thank you all for being with us today. And I hope you enjoy the other sessions in our event. Sorry.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. And goodbye. Enjoy the rest of the event.